Virgil Ortiz, experienced, even though he is only 21 years old, a serious young fighter who comes in with an unblemished record.
Antonio Orozco, nicknamed Relentless, only one loss. Orozco has promised to shine here tonight.
Ortiz with a beautiful hook. And the right hand, that hurts.
How about the underdog showing up tonight?
He is that fast.
Beautiful left hook.
We are thoroughly impressed with Virgil Ortiz. Does he have enough skill and energy at his age to keep Ortiz off of him?
We are live in the shadows of Dallas, the Big D. We're in Grand Prairie, about 15 miles west of the big city. In fact, we're inside the theater at Grand Prairie, a beautiful facility. It's hosted Eagles concerts, Justin Bieber, even Dora the Explorer Live. But this is the first ever boxing card being held here. And tonight's broadcast is brought to you by Tecate, the official beer of boxing. And Hennessy, never stop, never settle. A packed night of fights for you, ladies and gentlemen, and we start with Alex Rincon from nearby Dallas, 6-0 with 5 KOs, taking on Joel Guevara. And then it's Travel Maison from Austin, 14-0 with 12 KOs. He promises another one tonight against Jeremy Ramos. And in our featured prelim, Marcelino Lopez, the heavy-hitting Argentinian, squaring off against Mexico's Daniel Echevarria. Our main card begins at 9 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m. local. Hector Tanahara Jr. from San Antonio looks to remain perfect as he takes on Ezequiel Aviles. And then our co-main event. It is the final fight of this three-fight trilogy. The last two fights were epic encounters. Who's gonna get this one? Franco and Negrete. And of course, in our main event, Virgil Ortiz Jr., who is from Grand Prairie, ladies and gentlemen. In fact, he'll have his high school teachers in attendance tonight. His whole family will be here. The toughest night of his life, though, as he faces 28-1 Antonio Orozco. And with that, we welcome you inside the theater at Grand Prairie. My name is Todd Grisham, next to the Latin snake himself, Sergio Mora. Sergio, why is tonight's main event so important?
It's very important, especially for Virgil Ortiz. Ortiz is making his hometown, his much-awaited hometown, as a headliner. I mean, he's been crushing everybody. 13 wins, 13 knockouts. Can he continue that streak of knockouts here tonight?
What's on the line for Orozco?
Well, Orozco, you know, he's already been to the top. He came up short against the now unified world champion in Jose Ramirez. No bad things there. I mean, it's not really that bad if you're losing to one of the best fighters in the world. But Orozco needs a good win against a prospect and contender like Virgil Ortiz. It'll be a huge statement if he can do that tonight.
Well, Orozco did go the distance in that fight against Ramirez. Let's see if he can do the same thing tonight against Ortiz Jr. Now, Orozco moving up in weight for the first time. This is a new division for him, Sergio. How will he do at 147 pounds?
Well, he's flirted with the welterweight division before fighting in the mid-140s, but it's a big deal, especially when you're fighting a big welterweight like Virgil Ortiz, who's much taller, much stronger, much more powerful. It's gonna be a tall task for him.
Yeah, literally, as you can see, the height discrepancy between that stare down yesterday for the weigh-ins. All right, without further ado, we bring in the third member of our broadcast crew to get us ready for tonight's festivities. Hello, Claudia Trejos.
Hi, Todd. Hi, Sergio. Our co-main event, like you just mentioned, is the third of a trilogy. And let's remember the first fight. More than 1,000 punches were landed, and it was outrageous. It ended up on a split draw, a decision that both corners were very comfortable with. On the second fight, Franco took the win by a split decision. Negrete's corner, led by Manny Robles, was not very happy about that. They just figured, this happens in boxing, but it's not going to happen again. For this fight, they've decided they're going to be more aggressive. They're going to go look for the fight, because for Negrete, this could be a make or break. Let's remember, he's already 32 years old, and he's really looking at the last stretch of his career. Whereas for Franco, he's still in his 20s. A loss today, yes, it won't open the door for a title bout. It would just delay it just a little bit. But for Negrete, this is make or break. So we're looking at a phone booth fight, and it's going to be an action-packed fight that you do not want to miss. Back to you, Tom.
All right, now, not only is this a trilogy, but this is back-to-back back-to-back fights for these guys. They haven't fought anyone else. They're tired of looking at each other. We'll see who does something about it tonight. But first things first, we start in the super welterweight division. Alex Rincon and Joel Guevara. We send it into the ring in Jeremiah Gallegos.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, we are live for the Lone Star State. Ready for some more professional boxing action presented to you by Oscar De La Hoya's Golden Boy Promotions live on DAZN. Tonight's attraction set for six rounds of the super welterweight division. Introducing to you first, set to make his ring walk and fighting out of the blue corner from Charleston, West Virginia, USA, Joel Guevara.
Joel Guevara, he's 1-4 in his last five bouts, Sergio. That's the bad news. The good news is, though, he's coming off a win, a knockout over Tyler White.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, set to make his ring walk and fighting out of the red corner, here's one half of the fighting pride of Carrollton, Texas. Please welcome the undefeated Alex Rincon.
You can hear the ovation for Alex Rincon. He splits time right now between Washington, D.C. and Carrollton, Texas, which is about 20 or so miles from Grand Prairie. What do you like about this kid?
I like a lot about this kid. Not only his personality and temperament, but his fighting style. Everything about him is on pace to being something special in boxing. His brother George just got a dramatic first-round knockout. Let's see if Alex can do the same tonight.
He's never been down as a pro, and as you can see, very tall, especially for this division. And yet, Sergio, he's an excellent body puncher.
Excellent body puncher. Anytime you get a fighter that's over 6 foot, you never expect him to be a good body puncher, but he's lengthy, he's powerful, and he digs down to the body excellently.
Here is our tale of the tape for our opener here from Grand Prairie, Texas, Alex Rincon, 24 years old. He's 3 inches taller than Guevara and also will have a 4-inch reach advantage. Here are the rules for Texas. It's the unified rules of boxing. No 3-knockdown rule, no standing 8-count. You cannot be saved by the bell in any round, and only the referee can stop the fight. Back into the ring, and Jeremiah Gallegos.
Ladies and gentlemen, live on DAZN from right here in Grand Prairie, Texas, USA, at the theater at Grand Prairie, as we bring you live professional boxing, all presented to you by Oscar De La Hoya's Golden Boy Promotions, sponsored by Tecate, the official beer of boxing, and Hennessy, never stop, never settle. Tonight's attraction is set for 6 rounds in the super welterweight division. The 3 judges scoring the bout at ringside are Javier Martinez, Jesse Reyes, and David Iacobucci. And the 3rd man inside at the sound of the bell are referee Neil Young. And now, ladies and gentlemen, here we go for the introductions. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing black and red. He officially weighed in at 152.2 pounds. In 10 completed bouts, his professional record consists of 4 victories, 3 wins by way of knockout, and 5 defeats with 1 draw. From Charleston, West Virginia, USA, Joel Guevara. And across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing Cowboys blue with silver and white, he officially took the scales at 154.4 pounds in 6 professional bouts. His campaign stands perfect. 6 victories, including 5 wins by way of knockout and no defeats. Ladies and gentlemen, here's one half of the fighting pride of Carrollton, Texas. give the final instructions, Neil Young.
Okay, John, when we're in the dressing room, do you have any questions? Remember, obey my commands at all times. Touch them up. Good luck to you.
Alex Rincon 6-0 with 5 knockouts. His last fight, the only one to go the distance. Sergio, he told us yesterday, I'm going to get back on the KO train. I had the last guy hurt but couldn't put him away. I won't make the same mistake twice.
No, Alex said he gave himself a B- for that performance. I think he was a little hard on himself, but tonight if he can do that, it'd be very impressive.
So here we go. Alex Rincon in the blue and silver, scheduled for 6. Guevara in the black and red. You can already tell there's going to be a distinct length advantage for Alex.
Not only that, but Rincon is a southpaw. So not only is he taller, longer reach, but he's going to have to deal with the southpaw as well.
We saw Guevara a couple months ago, taking on Ammo Williams, another hot prospect you'll see on DAZN. Ammo put Joel Guevara away. Let's see if Rincon can do it in his home state of Texas. And as Sergio mentioned, Alex's brother George fought earlier tonight, and Alex was sitting here ringside about an hour ago in a t-shirt, hands weren't wrapped, just having a good time.
A lot of shot there by Rincon. Anytime I see a tall fighter go down to the body, especially this early, it just shows how impressive they are. Their pedigree is there.
It's one of the reasons tall fighters don't go to the body is because it takes them so long to get that hand back up to their head to block a shot?
No, because you have to bend your knees more, and that takes more leg strength. So usually tall fighters like to use their advantages by standing tall. But if you want to use your lower body, you're going to have to fatigue your legs a little bit more. Not only that, but your back as well.
Right hand just grazed the temple of Guevara.
See, for a taller fighter, you want to utilize your jab and fight timing and distance. The body is always important, of course, but for taller fighters, it comes second. Jab is key.
Rincon is the younger brother, 3.5 years younger than George. Quick little left hand and another one scores for Rincon.
There's an uppercut, nice right hooker. But any time a southpaw is a right hooker like that, it's just very impressive.
Guevara was certainly hurt there, but not ruled a knockdown. Let's see if Rincon can put him there here.
His right hooks keep landing on Guevara. Guevara keeps taking them.
Guevara's got to get out of there. A nice body shot with the left hand for Rincon.
And that body shot will keep setting up the right hooks. But look at how poised Rincon is. He's 24 years old, but he knows that Guevara's not going to go anywhere yet. He's still pushing and punishing him downstairs and upstairs, but he's not going wild. He's still poised. I like to see that in young prospects.
Good 1-2 there for Rincon. 15 seconds to go here in the first round.
Rincon keeps digging to that body. Look at that.
Downstairs, upstairs with the right hand. Oh, another big shot. Straight left hand, and Guevara survives round one, but barely.
Hey, good job. Guess what? You made it to the second round. Good job, brother. Hey, hey, you fucking actually did really, really good. Give me some grief. He looked really good. He got caught. Let's get your head together. Stretch your jaw. I need some grease. Hey, listen.
Here we're going to see the right hook. It just kept landing because Guevara is keeping his chin up in the air. His hands aren't high. He's punching with the taller, stronger fighter. And here's another look. There's that right hook, and it landed more than once. But credit to Guevara. He took those right hooks.
Seconds out. Let's go.
Here we're going to see the end of the round.
Seconds out.
The right hand kept landing, but Rincon did not forget about the body. I love seeing that in prospects.
Let me quote what the advice was from the corner. Good job, you made it to the second round.
Yeah, David Bowers, his trainer, was actually surprised that he made it to the second round.
What's he gonna do if he makes it to the third?
Painful experience to tell you that, because Rincon is on with those right hooks and body shots.
Oh, nice right hand, right on the chin. As Guevara takes a step back, it seems like it's just a matter of time here before Rincon puts his final stamp on proceedings.
Rincon just barely missed.
Oh, that right hand on the temple. Down goes Guevara.
With the right hook again. Rincon cannot miss with that right hook.
He may just ride it out. He does. And Alex Rincon back on the KO train with win number 7.
Back-to-back knockout losses for Joel Guevara. The first was at the hands of Amel Williams, and now Alex Rincon here in his home state of Texas. Fans love it.
Rincon was basically upset that he couldn't get a knockout in his last fight, somewhat embarrassed perhaps. Tonight, he said there's no way Guevara's making that out of here on his feet. And boy, did he not put his stamp on proceedings with that knockout of Guevara, round number 2. And how good does it feel when you do it 20 miles from your hometown?
I wouldn't know, but look, both Rincon brothers came out and got first round knockouts. How impressive is that?
Let's show it to you one more time here in round 2.
And it was all right hooks by Rincon. There's that right hook. It couldn't miss on Guevara. Rincon came with uppercuts, but he did not neglect the body. I love seeing young prospects do not forget the body. And there it is right there. And that's what set up that massive right hook. Guevara couldn't take many of those. And here we're going to see another look of the same punches. Left hook to the body. Right hooks cannot miss. Alex Rincon with an impressive first round knockout, just like his brother earlier in the night. One more look. Beautiful combination coming from downstairs. That right hook would have ended it, but boom, did not forget to repeat the same punch. And it was good night for Guevara. Look at that smile on Alex Rincon's face. That's just a look of a job well done right there. And now we're gonna throw it up to the final announcer with Jeremiah Gallegos.
Ladies and gentlemen, our referee, Neil Young, reaches the count of 10. The official time comes to you 58 seconds into round 2 for your winner by KO and still undefeated, the fighting part of Carrollton, Texas, Alex Rincon!
There's that young man right there. Both the Rincon brothers with impressive first round knockouts earlier in the night. His older brother, George, got a beautiful first round knockout as well. Let's go back and look at that stoppage. Earlier in the night, George Rincon, the older brother of Alex, with a brutal one punch knockout here. And it was a right hook just as well. Not only are they brothers, but they knocked out their opponents with the same punch. And here we're going to see his brother, his younger brother, Alex, knock out his opponent with the exact same punch. How incredible is that? Rincon with the right hooks. Now we throw it to Todd Grisham.
All right, congratulations in order for Alex Rincon. They just showed your brother's knockout as well. Who got the better knockout here tonight?
I'm humble, so I'm not going to say anything.
But how important was it for you? Your last fight went the distance, the first one of your career. How important was it for you to get a KO here tonight in front of your home state fans?
I mean, it's very important. You always want that knockout. Of course, I want to give my fans a show. They all pay good money to come out here, so I'll make sure they saw a knockout. But on top of that, it was a very emotional win for me just because of, you know, everything's going on in the world right now. You know, this world needs more love, more peace. A lot of crazy stuff going on right now.
Take us through that knockout. When did you know you had him?
I knew I had him hurt in the first round. I saw some shots, and I knew he wasn't going to be able to take that anymore. I just had to pick my shots. I was a little, just kind of overpatient that first round. But, you know, once my manager, Coach Lamont Roach, told me he's not gonna make it past the second round. Don't let him even last. So I went out there. I saw the switch up of gears was there, so I finished it.
All right, let's show it to you one more time as you take us through it. It took you two rounds to do it. Yeah. Walk us through this.
So I saw I had him hurt with that hook. I saw I slipped that jab, and I came with that uppercut up the middle, came with that hook up top, and landed two more shots on the way down.
All right, you told me that you would like to maybe go 8 rounds, 10 rounds sooner than later. How soon are you going to be ready for a step up in competition and a step up in rounds?
Whenever my manager is ready, you know, at the end of the day, I do my fighting. He manages my career. I trust him as family. You know, I love him to death, and so I trust everything he has planned for me.
All right.
And the man upstairs.
All right, congratulations one more time for Alex Rinko. And now we send it to Claudia Trejos, who's standing by with MyZone.
Ready than we were the first time around, so you're gonna see a better Andy Ruiz the second time
back
around.
How does it feel after so many injuries and many health issues to be back 100%?
Oh, yeah, like I said, it's a blessing to be back. It was a really tough road to go through with injuries, you know, manager issues and everything. But like I said, it's a blessing to be back home.
And during those layoffs, you did mention that you took the opportunity to change your style, make adjustments. How did you make those changes, and how did your style change?
It changed due to the fact that I used to just go in there and try to knock my opponent out, you know, get him out of there real quick and go home and, you know, celebrate real quick. But I know I love the fun of boxing, the sport, the sweet science of it, you know, sit back, relax, pick your shots, and have fun with it. So, you know, that's what I love to do, and, you know, I still love a knockout, but, you know, that's what I'm not always looking for. I'm always looking for a boxing lesson and to teach my opponent, hey, you make a mistake, I'm going to make you correct it.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, and good luck.
Thank you so much.
What a way to start the broadcast, Sergio. A knockout by Alex Rincon. And now we can see Trevel Maison as he squares off against Jeremy Ramos. Here is an 8-rounder from the super welterweight division.
Ladies and gentlemen, we resume the action from here in the Lone Star State. We are live on DAZN. Tonight's attraction presented to you by Oscar De La Hoya's Cold Import Promotions. Our next attraction is set for 8 rounds in the super welterweight division. Introducing to you first, set to make his ring walk and fighting out of the blue corner, representing Bayamon, Puerto Rico, and fighting out of Colorado Springs, Colorado, Jeremy Ramos.
Jeremy Ramos coming off a win over Nico Mycias, one of my favorite fighters, a guy that just throws punches. And when I say nonstop, I mean nonstop, even when he's getting hit in the face. So the fact that Ramos could beat a fighter like that tells you how tough he is.
Absolutely. Ramos comes to fight. And yeah, you know, that fight with Nico Mycias, that was impressive because Nico is nonstop, 100 punches around, fights inside and outside, cagey and dirty, so he knows that he can stand outside and box or brawl inside, Jeremy Ramos.
He also works as a full-time barber and gave Adrian Broner a haircut once, if that means anything to you. Here's our tale of the tape. Ramos is 8 years older than Trevel Maison. But look at Maison, 4 inches taller, and will have a 3-inch reach advantage.
Ladies and gentlemen, at the request of Trevel Maison, who is set to make his ring walk, he has asked that you join him in silence and use your flashlight on your mobile devices tonight in memory of those who fell victim in the recent violence here on American soil.
Let's go!
Ladies and gentlemen, boxing fans, we are live on DAZN from the theater at Grand Prairie, Texas, USA. Tonight, Oscar De La Hoya's Golden Boy Promotions brings you a night of world-class boxing, sponsored to you by Takata, the official beer of boxing, and by Hennessy. Never stop, never settle. Tonight's attraction is scheduled for 8 rounds of the super welterweight division. The 3 judges scoring the bout at ringside are David Iacobucci, Javier Martinez, and Jesse Reyes. And the 3rd man inside the ring at the sound of the bell, referee Lawrence Cole. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we are set for 8 round attraction right here in the ring. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the colors of Puerto Rico, red, white, and blue. He officially weighed in at 153.2 pounds. In 17 professional fights, his record consists of 11 victories, 4 wins by way of knockout against 6 defeats. Fighting out of Colorado Springs, Colorado, y representando Bayamón, Puerto Rico, Jeremy Ramos. And across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing black and white, he officially tipped the scales at 152 pounds even. In 14 professional fights, his record is unblemished. 14 victories, 12 big wins by way of knockout, and no defeats. Hailing from the capital city of the Lone Star State, Austin, Texas, Trevor Black Magic Mesa. And tell referee to give the final instructions, Lawrence Cole.
All right, gentlemen, went over there and rules early in the dress room. Obey my commands. Protect yourselves all times. Touch them up. Good luck.
So a very nice thought-out gesture by Travell Maison. And now he gets to do what he does, and that's go for knockouts. 12 KOs in his 14 wins as he squares off against Jeremy Ramos. Ramos born in Puerto Rico, but he's lived in Colorado Springs virtually his entire life. Dad was in the military. He's wearing the colors of the Puerto Rican flag. Maison in the black and white. Will this one go longer than the Alex Rincon fight, Sergio?
I believe so, yes. Maison extremely tall for this weight division at 6'2", but he's very agile as well. He's athletic. He doesn't like to really engage. He keeps his hands down. He's very flashy in there.
His nickname is Black Magic. We asked him where he got that from. He said, well, in sparring, people couldn't touch me. He said it looked like a magic. So I called it Black Magic. So that's where he is with that nickname. Where'd you get the Latin Snake nickname?
It was a little bit of reporters calling me slick and slithery and stuff like that. So it was snake-like. I added the Latin.
You still are described as slithery.
See how patient Maison is.
Hey, if Ramos is going to pull off the victory here, the upset, what does he have to do?
Well, it's a feeling out process right now. He's fighting the taller fighter, the younger fighter, the more powerful fighter. So he has to go in there and he has to fill out the jab, the speed, the timing of Maison. You don't want to go in there and just throw haymakers right off the bat. It's an 8-round fight. Take your time.
Interesting footnote, Jeremy Ramos is the man who went the distance with Alex Rincon, who you just saw. No one had been the distance with him. So Ramos, a tough customer. Won't be easy for Maison to get him out of there. About 8 rounds to do it. That's it. Maison, his most recent fight, a first-round knockout over Mexico's Alan Zavala, who was 15-2. Now, an 11-month layoff since then because he tore his left bicep in that bout. Doesn't look like he's suffering any ill effects from that.
No, not at all. Stinging jab. Ramos's corner wants him to throw a right hand right after.
The feet just disappeared underneath Ramos. I don't know what happened. Usually it's a shot to the temple.
We'll have to see that on replay, but it is a knockdown.
And his feet are still shaky.
Come to me.
All right. We got 30 seconds. Real feather in the cap of Maison if he can get Ramos out of there, especially in round one. And it's been all behind that jab.
Everything behind that jab. When you're 6'2", you want to use that. You want to utilize your advantages. Let your opponent make the mistake. Let Ramos get desperate, which he did right there in the toss-up.
Still trying to find his foundation as Ramos. He's hoping that bell will ring soon.
But credit to Ramos. He's punching back against the ropes.
Did you see the punch that landed?
No, I didn't.
Well, at least we both missed it.
Okay, breathe deep, breathe deep. Relax, okay? How about move your legs a little bit more? Don't stay in front of him, okay? Move around.
You know. What's this? Where's the ice coming from?
Move around for a couple of rounds, okay? But throw more combinations and coming angles. Don't stay in front of him. After the six.
Let's see, Sergio. I predict a shot to the temple.
There it is right there. I thought that punch missed. Maison's back was towards me, and I thought that punch missed, but it was a glancing punch, and sometimes those are the ones that take away your legs when they barely graze your temple. And here's one more look. I could tell you, Todd, those are grazing punches. They look like they're not landing solid, but those take your legs away from you.
It's probably a punch that didn't even hurt him. His legs quit working.
Equilibrium goes out with those punches. They don't land solid. It's just grazing punch, grazing power.
Let's see if Ramos has collected his faculties as we go into round two, scheduled for 8 here.
For a tall fighter to throw a left hook like that, it's very impressive.
Maison looking good as ever, 14-0, 12 KOs. Used to train with Ann Wolf, switched trainers, and was telling us some stories. We know how, I would say, hard of a trainer she is, or a trainer that pushes you to the edge. He said she made him run 8 to 10 miles every morning, and when he cut his grass, he had to wear sauna suits. Said she absolutely killed me. She would even cut the ring in half and make him fight 2 people at once.
2 people at once, and once he sparked 17 rounds straight with Ann Wolf. Ann Wolf was a champion herself. She made a name for herself with not only winning the title, but also with James Kirkland, another devastating puncher in the junior middleweight division. I had him in camp one time, and he was grueling. Him and Ann Wolf in camp were tough for me, and I was paying them for the sparring sessions.
Now being trained by Ozell Nelson the last 4 years. Nice hook to the body for Maisel. He's not wasting any time in this fight.
No, and he's going to the body. I mean, that's just really impressive, especially after that first round knockdown.
Ramos got a couple shots in there, but that just seems to spur Maison on.
And it's because Maison's getting aggressive. Ramos was able to land a left hook right there. Maison does keep his hands low. That's part of his style. He likes to keep him hands low, and the punches come from the bottom to the top.
Ramos's corner keeps calling for an overhand right. They think they see something.
Well, you got to set up that overhand right. You just can't throw it and expect it to land. You got to set him up downstairs.
Here we go. Travell Maison with a little shimmy saying Ramos is not hurting him. Ozell Nelson, his trainer, used to be the trainer for Jermaine Taylor, world champion. Eight of the 12 knockouts for Maison came in round one.
And you can see flashes of Jermaine Taylor with Maison fighting behind the jab, but Maison's a lot better of a body puncher, and he's a lot more fluid with his combinations as well.
Well, Taylor did some things pretty well too, did he not?
No, absolutely. He had a devastating right hand. I have history with Taylor. I fought him in the Olympic trials. I was supposed to fight him as a pro for the undisputed middleweight championship. I have history with him, definitely. See that punch right there by Ramos? It came up short, but he's punching between the shots of Maison, which is probably the best thing to do with the taller, stronger fighter.
So an entertaining round between Maison and Ramos.
Hey, that body itself. Keep standing behind that jab.
Next time you threw that hook.
But he is going to slow down. You know he's going to slow down for the third. He's no use to pass the third round. We're going to take it to the latest round, okay? We're going to take
it. Here we're going to see Ramos throw two counters there. Glancing blows a right hook and a left hook, but here we're going to see Maizan's reaction, a little shimmy shake, and he comes back with a 1-2, and that body shot right there was really impressive. But at the end of the round, here we have Jeremy Ramos coming right back. He has the right idea. Punch is coming a little short, but that's exactly what you want to do against a taller, stronger fighter.
Travell Maizan, an amateur with 65 wins, only 10 losses, but one of those losses came to George Rincon, who fought earlier tonight. Who knows if they'll ever cross paths again. Round three scheduled for 8. How has Ramos looked since that knockdown in the first?
He looked pretty good. I mean, his legs are under him. His knees were buckling a little bit when he got up off that knockdown, but he reacted well, and he's doing the right thing. I mean, he's a brave fighter. He's doing the right thing. He's still punching really hard, like he is right there, coming forward.
Is Maizan being a little over-aggressive, in your opinion?
A little over-aggressive behind that jab. You wanna use different jabs. You wanna use a sneaky fast jab, a power jab, jab downstairs, jab to the shoulder and chest. But every jab can't be the same, or else you will get timed over the top.
Ramos's corner pleading with him not to go to the body, but to go to the head. You don't hear that a lot.
No, I mean, but in order to set up those overhand rights and lefts, you have to go to the body. Fighters like Maizan are too experienced for that. They can't fall for it.
Well, Maizan said he wants to have fun in the ring and not just hunt for knockouts all the time. We're seeing glimpses of the old, more aggressive Maizan right now, though.
Aggressive, but he needs to keep those hands up. I know that's his style. He likes to keep that left hand low, but it's, I mean, you really got to be careful, especially with a fighter like Ramos that's punching in between the shots.
A lot of Texas fighters on the card. Maizan, born in Florida, but has lived in Austin, Texas since the age of 6. Nice 1-2, the downstairs with the left hook. Just missed that liver.
That 1-2 was just to set up that liver shot. There it is again.
Boy, Ramos is here to fight, though. I'll give him that.
Both of them exchanged left hooks, both landed. Maizan better be careful when he's exchanging punches with Ramos. Ramos is that's exactly what he has in mind. Just to counter the punches of Maizan. The more aggressive Maizan.
Getting down to the body, you've got to wonder if one of those left hooks is going to score right on the liver and send Ramos to the canvas.
I would love to see Maizan double those left hooks to the liver, because the first one, you know what's coming. Ramos braces for that first left hook, but if he doubles it, he might think it's going upstairs and that might hurt more.
Ramos backpedaling now as Maizan tries to step in, swings him to the ground, he'll be warned for that.
No more of that, all right? Understand? All right, touch it. Okay.
10 seconds to go. Little slapping left hook for Ramos scores. And there are opportunities for Ramos to land big punches against Travell Maizan.
Yes, because Maizan's keeping his chin in the air and getting a little bit too cocky. Ramos had some success with body shots right there. Here we're going to see Ramos early in the round. He's setting up the overhand left and right with the body shot. They weren't landing cleanly, but he had the right idea. See those body shots right there? That left hook landed. Maizan countering with his left hook. They're exchanging left hooks, which is dangerous for a taller fighter to do. And here we're going to see the push down by Maizan.
More of a throw.
Push, throw, but Lawrence Cole, the referee, did the right thing, gave him a harsh warning. One more and you might get a point deducted.
I almost jumped on top of him.
Did you expect that we would see this type of fight?
Yeah, you know what? Ramos he's an experienced fighter. I mean, he has 17 fights under his belt. He's aggressive. Like you said earlier, he beat a tough guy in Nico Macias earlier in the year.
Well, he's lost 5 of his last 7, though, but Fighting with confidence is Jeremy Ramos. And there are chances for him to score big in this fight. Unless Maison decides to change tactics and be a lot less aggressive. That doesn't seem to be his style. There's a left hook that connects. Ramos fires back, hits him with the left hook.
Ramos is
and gets him again.
Barely missing with those left hooks. Dead on the chin there. Maison better be careful. Tuck that chin in, pick that right hand up.
Only four knockouts for Ramos in his 11 wins, so not really packed with power. Perhaps that's why you're seeing so much braggadocious behavior from Maison. Feels that Ramos simply can't hurt him.
Ramos can't hurt him. I mean, both these guys can, they know how to punch. They're professional fighters. A punch definitely can hurt, especially when you have your chin up in the air like Maison does. But he's very comfortable in there. Obviously, he has swag and confidence and experience, but he needs to stay patient and disciplined, fighting behind that jab. Don't fight Ramos's fight.
Is this the kind of fight Maison wanted after an 11-month break? Competitive fight where he's got to be on his P's and Q's against this guy.
Maybe not what he wanted, but it's what he needed. He needs rounds. Maison has changed trainers from Ann Wolf to Ozell Nelson, but he still has the same instincts. He's still making the same, I don't want to call them mistakes because he's getting away with them, but he's still hands low, chin up in the air, a little bit too confident. Same style of fighting, even though they have different trainers now.
Maison missed the last 11 months because of a torn bicep. And then from March 2015 to April 2017, so basically 2 years, he missed out because of autoimmune hepatitis. So couldn't fight, waited till he was 100% healthy, and then came back in. So he's still only 24, but has already had some medical setbacks. Almost at the halfway point here in Grand Prairie, Texas. Juan Francisco Estrada defends a super flyweight title in Hermosillo, Mexico against Dwayne Beeman. That's August 24th on DAZN.
He's gonna get tired. He's slowing down. He's slowing down.
Sergio Ramos' corner has been constantly telling him we're gonna tire him out and get him in the later rounds. Do you agree?
Well, because of the inactivity, I could understand why Ramos's corner would think that. Inactivity does kill timing. It kills, it saps your confidence in there. But right now, Maison, he's been looking confident. I would love for him to continue fighting behind the jab, a smart jab, a stinging jab, switch him up, get Ramos to make the mistakes and get desperate, having to come in there and break that distance.
If you're just joining us, Maison put Ramos down in the first round, but since then it's been lopsided, but at the same time competitive, because Ramos has gotten his shots in as well.
Ramos has the right idea, punching in between the punches. I would love to see him use his jab a little bit more, double jab. jab downstairs to the chest. Just hit something. You don't always have to land your jabs. You're setting up for the bigger shots.
Maison told us he's at his best when he's relaxed and having fun, and he was just singing along to Juicy by Notorious B.I.G. in the corner. So I think he's pretty relaxed.
That's the case for every boxer. Believe it or not, you got to suppress all your anxiousness. You want to fight as cool as possible because you also take a better punch when you're relaxed.
But you know what Anthony Joshua said? He thought he fought too relaxed against Andy Ruiz Jr.
That can happen as well, so there's a fine medium there. You want to be relaxed. You take punches a lot better when you're relaxed, and things come off real easily because when you're boxing, it's all repetitive nature in there. It's everything you practice.
Muscle memory.
Muscle memory, that's exactly what it is.
That's what happens when I see a threat of a fight somewhere. My muscle memory allows me to run out the nearest exit.
I noticed that, yep.
Have you given Ramos a round?
No, but he's been competitive in one or two rounds. He's landed some good shots. I mean, look, we know he's the B-side here. We know who the favorite is, the undefeated fighter, Travon Maison here, but he's holding his own, and these are the type of fights that Ramos has always been in. You mentioned earlier he's lost 5 of his 7, so this is nothing new to him, being in competitive losses. But he's only one big win away from getting another bigger fight.
He's starting to take it now towards Maison. Caught him again, but I just don't think that Ramos has the power to hurt Maison. At least not yet. Get in. He's longer. He's tall. We got to get in. 10 seconds to go here in round 5.
Get that right hand. No.
That's a body shot there from Maison.
I would love to see him double it up, though.
Time!
Coming up next, ladies and gentlemen, there they are getting ready. Marcelino Lopez and Daniel Echevarria. What's that fight going to look like, Sergio?
Well, I'm curious to see how powerful Lopez is. I mean, we know the numbers say he's powerful. He says he's powerful. I would love to see him display it tonight, see if it's that real heavy-handed power or that one-punch power.
Said he knows another fellow Argentine boxer very well, The Machine.
Keep boxing. Keep doing what you're doing. He ain't got a chance as long as you stay slick behind that jab. Mixing that jab up. Man, you need to start going up and down with it.
Up and down?
Yeah.
Come on, sir. All right. There you go.
And of course, by The Machine, I mentioned Lucas Matisse.
La Machina.
Haven't seen him since his fight.
Thank you.
In Malaysia, a loss to Manny Pacquiao. Round 6 now, scheduled for 8. If Ramos was hoping to do something in the later rounds, now's the time to shine.
Ramos' corner wants him to get in the inside, but that's going to be a difficult task for him because Maison has been keeping his distance behind a power jab. But in order for Ramos to be successful, he's going to have to take chances. Right there, he took a chance and caught a right hand for it.
Well, earlier, Maison was coming right into his wheelhouse in rounds 2, 3, and 4, but since then, he's stayed outside using that jab as a big stick.
Because he realized that Ramos wasn't going anywhere, especially after he got up from that knockdown. Ramos has only been stopped one time, and that's by Daniel Valdivia. He's not a big puncher, he's more of a mover as well.
Let's see how much urgency there is for Maison to get another knockout here, or if he's just going to try and roll this thing out and get a win. It's been all black magic through 5 full rounds, including that knockdown in round 1.
Those punches right there, they're not aimed at the head or the body. He's just punching at the shoulders, but anything, as long as you're getting confidence punching something, the head or the body will open up. Ramos' corner is warning their men not to back straight up, especially with the chin in the air. Use the angles when you're getting in, get out on an angle, left or right, pick one.
Ramos showing you how tough he can be. Went the distance with Alex Rincon, the only man to do that. Beat Nico Macias in Indio, California back in March. And now giving Maison a pretty tough test here in Texas.
I would like to see more head movement by Ramos. If he's gonna go inside, like his corner wants him to, he needs to move his head. Right there, he's starting to move his head now. He's gonna have any chance. He's gonna have to double or triple jab his way in, moving his head. That's what shorter fighters have to do with taller, rangier fighters.
Try to double jab there.
If you give your opponent a stationary target, they will land that long right hand, just like Jermaine Taylor would do. I mean, he would set up fighters with a strong power jab and end it with a long right hand.
10 seconds left. A rather pedestrian round, especially for Treyville Maison.
Time!
Hey, you gotta go at it. He's going down, man. He's gonna go down now.
Jeremy, he cannot take your power.
He cannot take your power, man. He's going down.
Stay
inside, like you did to the rooster. Stay inside and put a lot of pressure. He's running for you now. He's carrying power now. He's carrying power. You're in better shape.
And here we're gonna see a right hand by Maison that Ramos takes really well. He's been taking the punches on the chin nicely, and maybe that's why they have such confidence in Ramos' corner, and they want him to keep coming at Maison. That right hand landed solid on the way in.
And nice job by Maison to get out before he caught the receipt. You were pretty good at that too.
Yep, yes I was.
Stay back.
6 minutes to go, round 7 scheduled for 8. Treyville Maison, 14-0 with 12 knockouts. Looking to remain perfect, taking on Jeremy Ramos, born in Puerto Rico, now lives in Colorado.
You see Ramos coming in with double jabs. That's something his corner wants him to do, double and triple the jab. If he can throw it to the chest and the stomach and the torso area, he doesn't always have to be aiming for the head.
Entering tonight, Ramos had only been down twice. He's been down once in this fight in round number 1. Ramos's corner telling him that Maison is going down. He'll have to if Ramos wants to win this fight. Can't get it done on points, or so it seems. Maison pretty much in control. 90% of this fight.
See, Ramos is starting to double jab now, but he's still coming up short. Now he needs a triple jab. Triple jab before you throw that right hand. There you go, but you gotta keep coming. But if you don't do that in the gym, you're not gonna do it here when the lights
right.
are on.
It's like on the golf course where somebody says, hey, why don't you try hitting your 3-wood like this? And you've never tried it on the driving range. We know what happens to you, Sergio.
Oh, I'm horrible with that 3-wood.
It's going in the woods.
See, that's the thing. Whenever you're dealing, you got to do all this in the gym. And Ramos, if he didn't do this in the gym, then his legs aren't going to cooperate with him. If he wants to double, triple, and quadruple his way in, left knee to be under him.
There's a left hook that scored for Ramos.
And it was behind 2 jabs. See that? I like that now. Jab upstairs and downstairs. If he could triple that up, double and triple that up before he throws the right hand, then he's going to have more success. Not only that, but he starts getting a little bit more momentum. You know, it's not just Maison on the end looking for a power jab.
Well, Maison's no dummy. As you can see, when Ramos starts to throw the jab, he's backpedaling out of it.
Yeah, he steps back and looking for the right hand in the counter. See, Maison right there just doing footwork. Footwork and feints are just keeping Ramos with his punches holstered there. with the power of a feint. Beautiful body shot there by Ramos.
Give the crowd a little buzz. Nice couple shots there, and Maison catches him with a left hook.
Ramos with a flurry, Maison coming right back.
Good round for Jeremy Ramos. But does he have the power to hurt Maison?
He's landing the punches, and he's landing them right on the chin, especially a left hook at the end of that round.
Tell me what it feel like to have no fear at all and do it here in real life. Real time right now, all day long. I know it's special and I know you know it feels right. You're the reason it will last forever. You're the star that's staring back up in the mirror. Feels special when you stand out from the rest. When you know that you're the best.
Calm down, calm down. Superstar in the making, Devin Haney back on DAZN to take on Zaur Abdullayev live from Madison Square Garden at the Hulu Theater, September 13th.
We're going to look at the end of the round. Both of them landed good flurries, left hooks and right hooks. Both had their moments landing nicely right there. That gave Jeremy Ramos a lot of confidence.
Maison trying to get this crowd pumped up here at the start of the eighth and final round. And here's the dilemma for Maison. Does he just coast, stay outside, bounce around the ring and get the decision win, or does he go in for the kill?
Well, Ramos got momentum going, that blood is flowing. He knows this is the last round, so maybe it might be smart for Maison to fight behind that jab. When you know it's the final round, your momentum and your blood is boiling, you know it's the final thing. You don't want to leave nothing in there. So sometimes you got to be more careful if you're the one ahead on points. Like Maison is probably ahead on points.
Probably.
It should be.
Nice little uppercut to finish off that combination for Travell Maison, looking for his 15th win. Started boxing at the age of 6. Did Travell said his brother took him to the gym, never left. Fell in love with it that day. He's now 24. How would you rate the performance of Maison so far?
Well, look, he has a tough fighter in front of him, Ramos. He did put him down, but he needs to be careful. He's fight behind the jab. He's undefeated. He has a nice knockout percentage. We know he has the power, but now we know he has the discipline as well.
Good right hand there for Maison as Ramos tries to close the distance. Connected with the right hand there, but again, Maison didn't flinch. Maison is giving him a chance here, Sergio.
I'll tell you what, Maison could take a punch because he got hit with some good shots right there, left hooks and right hands.
Grazing right for Maison.
There's another right hand by Ramos. See, this is what I mean, Todd. I mean, even though it's the final round, Maison still needs to be careful. It only takes one punch to knock you out or get you hurt. Your head on the points, coast into a decision if you think that's the thing to do.
Ramos's corner continuously told him, we're gonna get him in the later rounds, we're gonna wear him down. Here's the chance, 30 seconds to go in the final round. Right hand, left hand, and again Maison shakes it off. Seconds left. Are they going to go toe-to-toe one more time? Ramos with a haymaker just misses. And that will do it. Good stuff for Travell Maison and Jeremy Ramos. More entertaining than you thought it would be?
Yes, it was. You know what? You got to give credit. We talked about how Jeremy Ramos lost 5 of his last 7 fights, and he probably ended up losing this fight as well. But still, this is the reason he continues getting these fights, especially the way he ended the fight against a taller, bigger, stronger Travel Maison.
And let us remember, or not forget, rather, that Ramos was dropped in round 1. Looked like he might not be able to continue. Not only did he continue, he may have won a couple rounds down the stretch. But a solid outing tonight for the man nicknamed Black Magic.
And here we're going to see some replays of the action. Maison was keeping his chin a little bit too high in the air. The arms are down, but that's his style of fighting. But the better opposition that he faces, he needs to check that. Because Ramos did land some punches in the inside right there. That was a right hand. Maison landed a counter left hook. They both took some good punches. You asked me, Todd, to grade Maison's performance. Well, I gave his chin an A because he took some good shots in this fight. Now we throw it to Jeremiah.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, after an 8-round slugfest, let's give our two warriors a big round of applause. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we go to the judges' scorecard. Judge Jesse Reyes sees the bout 80-71. Judges Javier Martinez and Judge David Akabuchi has the bout 78-73. Ladies and gentlemen, for your winner by unanimous decision, and still undefeated from Austin, Texas, Travel Black Magic Maison.
80-71. One judge had it a shutout. The other two judges had it 78-73. That sounds good to me, 78-73. But all in all, Maison with a good performance, a tough performance, had to take some good shots, and here we're gonna see some highlights. Maison started off with a first, with a knockdown there, but Ramos got up, kept swinging, especially in between the shots of Maison, which always makes it difficult for the taller fighter to get going when a fighter keeps punching in between your shots. A little shimmy there by Maison. The confidence did not fade, even though he was getting hit occasionally. Ramos, gritty, cagey, kept coming forward with the right game plan. The later this fight went, the more he started landed. But Maison took some good shots here and kept coming right back. It was an exciting fight here for the fans. And great sportsmanship. I love to see this kind of sportsmanship by two fighters. You know Maison was giving credit to Ramos here. Now we're going to throw it to Todd Grisham.
Here with Travel Maison, congratulations on your win. Back in the ring for the first time in nearly a year after a torn bicep. How do you feel?
Oh, man, I feel blessed, man. First and foremost, I want to thank God for this opportunity to show off in front of the fans, for the home, for the Dallas, man. Thank you for everybody coming out, man, and support, man. I feel amazing, man. I just want to keep going.
Was this a tougher fight for you than you expected?
Nah, I expected it to go this way, you know. I told everybody that I change up my style, you know, sit back, box, have fun. I ain't got to go out there and knock somebody out, you know what I'm saying, to show my skills. I just got to sit back, box, and have fun with it, and that's exactly what I did.
Now, you fought with your hands down a lot, your chin was up, you took some punches. Sergio said that you can do that, that's your style, but when you get against better opposition, you might be in a little bit of trouble. Do you feel the same way?
Nah, man, I mean, it's my style, you know what I'm saying? In boxing, you're going to take some hits. So, you know, you got to learn how to take a hit. I have to know how to take a hit, and I know how to come back from it, you know what I'm saying? So it's all the sweet science of boxing, baby.
And what do you want to do next now that you're back?
Hey, come on, man. I've called you out one time, Mike McGee. Look, you're fighting a guy I don't even know, man. Hey, come to me, dog. 15-0 with 12 KOs. Hey, man, come on, dude. I'm here. I don't like to talk no crap. I'm not a crap talker, but I want a belt, you know what I'm saying? Come get it. I'm here. We'll fight anywhere. I don't care. I don't care where it is. We fight here. I'm calling you. Let's go.
All right, congratulations. Well done. Once again, Travel Maison. And now to Claudia Trejos, who spoke earlier to Marcelino Lopez, the hard-hitting Argentinian.
Marcelino Nino Lopez, a few years ago, you knocked out Pablo Cesar Cano, who actually knocked out an elite fighter on Jorge Linares. Where does that put you in that division?
Sí, yo creo que hice lo que tenía que hacer en su momento cuando noqué a Pablo Cesar Cano. Después, el resultado de ellos es un resultado que pasa de una en 20 veces. Cosas que pasan en el boxeo y tienen la ventaja siempre el pegador.
The thing that I did with Pablo Cesar Cano is when I took advantage of that situation, and it's something that happens one out of every 20 times in boxing, and it's things that happens in boxing, I took advantage of the situation.
You've been working very hard to establish your name in this division. What do you need to do tonight to make that statement?
Tengo que hacer a lo que vine, tengo que brillar, tengo que hacer lo mejor, mostrar mi mejor versión como boxeador y esperemos una posibilidad cuanto antes mejor.
And I gotta do here what I came here to do, and that's to look good, do my best, and make sure I do a good job in the ring.
What does it mean to work out with Joel Diaz?
La verdad que muy contento, porque es un entrenador muy completo, muy competitivo, un entrenador que la verdad que marca sus pautas y sabe lo que quiere.
It's a very, I'm very happy because he's a complete trainer, he's a competitive trainer, and he's a trainer who really knows how to put out his guidelines and blueprints, so I'm very happy.
Thank you very much and good luck.
Muchas gracias.
So Daniel Echevarria back in action against Marcelino Lopez coming up next. Sergio, he is a very heavy-handed Argentine. In fact, in his last 8 fights, he has scored 12 knockdowns. What do you expect from him tonight?
I expect big power, but I want to see what type of power it is. Is it that concussive one-punch power like Matisse has, or is it a brutal beatdown type power like Madonna? But we do know he has that power, and his trainer says that he's one of the hardest punchers he's ever trained. So, I mean, that's a big deal there, especially when Robert Garcia says that this is one of the biggest punchers he's ever had.
His opponent, Echevarria, also with a very high KO ratio, 18 knockouts in 21 fights, but is he legit? Obviously, some of those knockouts came against less than stellar competition.
Well, we're going to find out because it takes character to take big power like that. So I don't know if Echevarria has been with fighters of that type of caliber and that type of power as well, because it only takes one punch. You don't practice on taking a punch, you know. So when you're dealing with punchers like this, you just got to go in there and you got to avoid that. You got to fight behind your jab. You gotta be smart.
All right, it feels like someone is gonna stop someone in this next fight. So let's get to it, ladies and gentlemen. It'll be Marcelino Lopez out of Argentina taking on Mexico's Daniel Echevarria.
Ladies and gentlemen, we continue the action from the theater at Grand Prairie, Texas, USA. Our next attraction is set for 10 rounds of the super lightweight division. Introducing to you first, set to make his ring walk and fighting out of the blue corner, the Durango, Mexico, Daniel Tocado Echevarria.
Echevarria started red hot, but has struggled lately. In fact, he had lost 7 of his previous 8 until scoring an upset knockout in the 8th round against Christian Alan Gomez Duran in his last fight. That took place in Mexico, and Duran was 16-1-1. So obviously, he is dangerous, especially from the southpaw position.
It's always dangerous when you're dealing with a southpaw, especially a power-punching southpaw like Echevarria. So you have to be careful if you're Lopez.
Echevarria, born in Gomez Palacio, Mexico. And he has 18 KOs in his 21 wins, 27 years old.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, set to make his ring walk. And finding out of the red corner, representando Buenos Aires, Argentina, Marcelino Nino Lopez.
Lopez told us yesterday he goes for the KO. That's all he's looking for, and he tends to get it. 20 knockouts and his 35 wins. He fought primarily in Argentina. 31-1 in that country. He's only had 4 fights in the U.S. He's 3-1.
Very powerful, and a slight correction from me. It's Joel Diaz in his corner, not Robert Garcia. But these are two fantastic trainers for Southern California. But yes, he is a puncher. Lopez is very dangerous. But Echeverria, very confident, and he's a southpaw with a power punch as well.
Back into the ring now, and Jeremiah Gallegos. Here is our tale of the tape. 33 years old, that's Marcelino Lopez, 27 years old for Echeverria. Lopez, the much shorter fighter, and Echeverria will hold nearly a 4-inch reach advantage over the veteran. Now to Jeremiah Gallegos.
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening to you all here live from the theater at Grand Prairie, Texas, USA. We are live on DAZN. Tonight's action is being presented to you by Oscar De La Hoya's Golden Boy Promotions and sponsored to you by Tecate, the official beer of boxing, and by Hennessy, Never Stop, Never Settle. Tonight's attraction is set for 10 rounds in the super lightweight division. The three judges scoring the bout at ringside are David Iacobucci, Javier Martinez, and Jesse Reyes. And our referee in charge of the action at the sound of the bell, Rosario Solis. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we are set for another Clásico, Mexico y Argentina. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing black trunks with trimmed with gold. He officially weighed in at 142.8 pounds. In 29 professional bouts, his record consists of 21 victories, 18 big wins by way of knockout against 8 defeats. De Durango, Mexico, Daniel Jacobo Echeverria. And finding out of the red corner, wearing green with white, he officially weighed in at 142.4 pounds. In 38 professional bouts, his record is impressive. 35 victories, including 20 wins by knockout and only 2 defeats with 1 draw. Ladies and gentlemen, representando desde Buenos Aires, Argentina, Marcelino Nino Lopez. Our referee to give the instructions, the final instructions, Rosario Solis.
Join me, guys, especially from the dressing room. Obey my commands at all times. Move up, protect yourself at all times.
Echeverria, 21-8, started out 18-0, Sergio, but since then, he's just 3-8, but has been matched very tough. Faced off against world title challenger Carlos Ocampo, Egidius Kavalauskas, who's likely to be Terrence Crawford's next opponent, and Olympic silver medalist Shakram Giasov, who you saw fight here on DAZN. He can't seem to beat the top tier guys. Let's see if he can buck that trend tonight against Marcelino Lopez. Lopez in the green, Echeverria in the black. Southpaw versus Orthodox. Todd Grisham, Sergio Mora here ringside. Our main card gets started at the top of the hour. We're leading to our main event, Virgil Ortiz Jr. from right here in Grand Prairie, Texas, taking on Antonio Orozco. What kind of fight is this going to be, Sergio?
Right now it's nice and quiet. You see Echeverria fighting behind the jab. The shorter Lopez needs to get in there. Look for the body shots. He's looking for the right shots. When you're such a power puncher like that, you know it just takes one punch, but you got to set that punch up, especially when you're dealing with a longer fighter like Echeverria.
Joel Diaz, when speaking about Lopez, says, listen, he hits you so hard that everywhere he touches you, he hurts you. If he unloads to the body, he'll put you down. Hit you on the head, he'll put you down.
And that's the thing with punchers like that. There's different styles of heavy punches. There's these the heavy-handed punchers that are slow. There's the fast twitch muscle punchers like that. But then there's the concussive one-punch power punchers. Like Julian Jackson, they knock you out, and you're out before you even hit the canvas.
Lopez, 33 years old. He needs to get things done. Seems like he's getting better with each fight, which is always a positive. His most recent fight, a six-round KO over former Mexican 140-pound titleist Jose Guillermo Garcia. It's a bit strange to see an Argentinian wearing Mexican colors. Usually it's that baby blue. That's what Lucas Matisse preferred to wear. In fact, Lopez told us he worked with Matisse over his last final three or four camps. Good friends.
See, when you match that tough as the Echeverria, you know how to use your advantages, and you learned off those tough fights like that. So power's not going to intimidate you, or speed, or even getting hit early in fights. You know, you're confident. You've been through the storm already. You're weathered.
Not much activity at all for Lopez so far. Almost giving this round to Echeverria, it seems.
Come on.
How you doing? Don't let him get too excited.
Hey,
just tranquil. You got to go inside and throw your shots. He's taller than you. Don't go straight back. His distance is, he wants to keep you from the fight. You got to get low. Move your waist in and out so you can go inside. Work the body.
See? Uno, dos, y nada más trabajando así, ya se quitó.
Just keep working.
Agua, dale agua.
Give him some water.
Hey, ya lo traes bien rojo.
Hey, you got him red. You know, keep working your left hand. Come on, let's go.
Round two. Contracted weight, 143 pounds. These are welterweights, scheduled for 10 in Grand Prairie, Texas. Very slow start for Marcelino Lopez.
When you punch as hard as Lopez, it only takes one shot. Sometimes that makes you a little bit overconfident with your power, and you let your opponent get confident and maybe even win rounds like that.
Or maybe he's just lulling Echeverria to sleep.
Yeah, that's exactly what he's probably doing. And fighters with that one-punch eraser, they get to do that. They have that luxury to even give up a couple rounds, just looking for that one big shot. And Virgil Ortiz, who we're going to see in the main event, said they've sparred before. He sparred with Lopez and said that he was the hardest puncher he's ever been hit by. That's a big statement.
Wait, Lopez said that against Ortiz or vice versa?
No, Ortiz said that Lopez was the strongest fighter he's sparred with.
And Ortiz Jr. has been in there with some very big names in sparring, at least.
Yes, he has.
Mikey Garcia, he's been in there with. Jose Ramirez.
Yes, trainer Joel Diaz said that it's raw power. It's just natural power. You can't teach that. And, you know, it's always exciting when you get to mold the fighter that has power like that. Because you could teach him the basics. You could teach him the speed and the angles and the combinations to throw and the timing, but you can't teach power.
Left hook right behind the ear for Lopez. Body shot on the inside there for Lopez.
Even with that body shot, you could see how powerful Lopez is. It was blocked, but it was vibrating. It was a very heavy-handed punch.
There's always that battle when it's a southpaw versus orthodox of whose foot can get on the outside, whose front foot.
Well, Lopez is doing a better job closing the distance now. You can tell he's a distance fighter. Very patient. He knows it just takes one punch.
Stop! Stop. Lopez, a former South American champion at 140 pounds, one of the greatest defensive fighters of all time, was a champion of this weight class from Argentina. Galinho, the untouchable Loche, world champion in the late 60s, early 70s.
Chavarria coming back with some nice combinations after being touched by a left hook there, so he would absorb the power of Lopez so far. Here we're gonna see Lopez come inside and land some good shots to the body. I mean, they were, like I said earlier, I mentioned they were vibrating. It sounded like a thump when he landed that. But credit to Echeverria at the end of the round, coming back with his own punches, not intimidated by that power. And like I said, when you're matched as tough as Echeverria has been, nothing surprises you. Coming back right now with a 1-2. That right hook barely missed, but that left hand landed.
Okay, bloquea y el cuando termine de trabajar, trabajalo tú.
Block.
Entendido?
Block, block, and throw Vamos. Your left.
Hey,
let's go.
Cruzado izquierda. Okay,
watch, Vamos. Watch the left cross.
Who'd you have winning those first two rounds?
I like the way Echeverria's fighting behind the jab. I would say Echeverria's doing nicely in those first two rounds.
If anything, it's just the fact that he's throwing more punches. But a more determined Lopez, it seems, coming out here in round three.
Well, Echeverria's fighting his fight, too. He's implementing his game plan. He's the taller fighter. He's fighting behind the jab. And the shorter fighter, we've seen flashes of it in the second round where Lopez wants to come in and break that distance. But I think Echeverria's been more successful from the outside. Good uppercut there by Echeverria.
Big swings and misses for Lopez.
Stop, stop. Looks.
Also tonight, it is the third fight in a trilogy, ladies and gentlemen. Joshua Franco taking on Oscar Negrete. That's our co-main event tonight. The first fight was a draw. The second one, a split decision win for Franco, which was bitterly contested by Negrete. He's got a chance to do something about it here tonight.
Lopez likes to catch left hooks with his own right hand and come back with that same punch. That's exactly how he was able to knock out Pablo Cano. Biggest win of his career. But against a southpaw, you can't really do that. You got to change up your strategy with a southpaw. Body shot there. Hey, Lopez.
This combination worked there for Echeverria. Caught him with the right hand.
Good right hook there by Echeverria.
The game plan is working well thus far for the Mexican.
Maybe fighting a lefty is throwing Lopez off. It's uncomfortable for him. Not only a lefty, but a taller lefty with some good power in Echeverria.
And you know, Echeverria not really sitting down on his punches yet either, just trying to score.
Echeverria has that lanky power, and Lopez has that stocky coming forward power. Nice combination. See, I like that by Echeverria. And he didn't stand there to get a receipt. He landed his combination and got out on an angle. That's a southpaw advantage. You can always escape to your right if you're the southpaw without pivoting your foot.
¡15 seconds to go here in the third round. Lopez trying to find his mojo still. Left hook connects there for Lopez.
Echeverria says, bring it on.
September 14th on DAZN. Jaime Munguia and Patrick Alade and Ryan Garcia taking on Avery Sparrow.
Hay que trabajar un poquito más.
Let's work harder. Come on. Throw your shots.
Here we're going to see a replay, a left hook landed by Lopez, but Echeverria took that punch well. And when you're as concussive of a power puncher like Lopez is, you got to give credit to the chin of Echeverria there.
Or the side of his forehead. Round four, scheduled for 10. Things looking pretty good for Echeverria. Lopez just trying to figure this guy out right now.
Both these guys rely on timing, that time power. Like I said earlier, there's different types of power. Neither of these guys is really fast. They don't have that speed type power. It's that concussive, slower, heavy-handed power, and both of them have it.
Some body shots now for Echeverria with the straight left.
It'll serve Lopez well.
Ooh, that right hand! There's the one-punch power from Lopez, and it sends Echeverria down.
That's exactly what I was going to say. It will serve Lopez right to go downstairs to the taller Echeverria.
Let's see if Lopez can close him out. The mouthpiece came out, which will buy Echeverria some time. Boy, that came out of nowhere, Sergio.
Yes, it did, and it was the perfect punch at the right time. That's exactly what Lopez needed to do. He's the shorter fighter. It's still early in the fight.
March.
Go downstairs.
So Lopez, who may have lost the first three rounds by the judges, answers back with a one-punch knockdown of Echeverria here in the fourth.
And you got to give it to Echeverria, coming right back with a body shot and headshots of his own. There's that right hand downstairs again by Lopez.
Well, can you recover quicker from a body shot as opposed to a headshot knockdown?
No way, no way. Body shots linger, that pain lingers.
A couple of straight lefts there for Echeverria.
It only takes one punch downstairs again to remind Echeverria of that pain. So it'll serve Lopez well if he can just concentrate on Echeverria's body. Forget about the head, go downstairs.
Everything was working so well for Echeverria, but it was stopped with a one-punch body shot from Lopez.
A combination by Echeverria. It was blocked by Lopez, but he's still feeling those.
Sergio being told now by our production truck that it was actually a right hand to the jaw. It was not a body shot.
Well, that makes sense, because Echeverria didn't react like it was a body shot when he got up. His back was turned towards us, so we didn't really see that punch land cleanly, but look at that body shot.
There's a slip for Lopez. But I will say this, Echeverria, since that knockdown, looks unscathed. Maybe winning the round since then.
If Echeverria can get away with a 10-9 round instead of a 10-8 round, it'll be success for him.
It's a big ask from judges. They don't like to do that unless it's clear.
Echeverria complaining about a punch behind the head.
Oh, and another left hand that time sends Echeverria down for the second time here in round four.
And Echeverria says that he got hit behind the head again.
I tell you what, Lopez is taking some deep breaths over there in the corner. And the mouthpiece comes out again. The referee telling me he'll take a point away if it happens again. But right now, we may have a 10-7 round for Lopez. That will do it. Let's watch the knockdown, Sergio. The first one came from a right hand to the jaw.
A counter right hand, and that's what Lopez does. That's how he knocked out Cano. He blocks a punch first, and then he catches and counters with that same right hand.
What a compact punch, too.
Well, when you're a compact fighter like Lopez is at 5'6", that's exactly the type of power he has. Here's a second knockdown. Echeverria going low, but Lopez with a sweeping left hook. And it was on the temple. That wasn't behind the head like Echeverria was claiming. It's right on the side of the head right there, which is legal. But those punches downstairs by Echeverria
aren't legal.
Well, I will say this. Looking in Lopez's corner, he looks extremely fatigued, Sergio. So he may try and buzz Echevarria out of there right now here in round five.
Well, yeah, he hasn't been, Lopez hasn't really been too active in throwing too many punches. I don't understand.
Another stiff right hand connects for the Argentine, who is pushing the tempo here. That's how you get back into a fight if you've lost the first three rounds, hypothetically. You knock your guy down twice, win 10-7.
You know, when you get hit on top of the head like that, sometimes you know, you're not used to blocking the top of your head. You know, the glove can only cover a certain part of your face. So when you get hit there, you're not expecting to get hit there, and sometimes it throws you off with that power. You're not used to getting hit. You think you're blocking your face, and then you get hit with a shot on your temple on top of your head. It's very surprising.
How hard is it to come back from a punch like that?
That's all character and gut, so we know Echevarria has that.
Right hand. He does not want to fight on the inside against Marcelino Lopez, no, that's for sure.
He doesn't want to fight on the inside, but he's been holding his own on the inside. So Echevarria, it serves him well to stay outside, but he's holding his own in the inside as well.
Stop. It's Mexico versus Argentina here in Texas. A featured prelim before the main card at the top of the hour here on DAZN.
Nice combinations there by Echevarria. Echevarria doing a really good job staying off the ropes, which is exactly where Lopez wants to get him.
Swing and a miss with the left hand, uppercut there for Echevarria.
And some good left hand, straight left hand, left uppercut Echevarria did. Good body shot there. Lopez is coming forward, but he's not really landing anything. Echevarria is doing more of the punching on his back foot. Boxing nicely, staying off the ropes.
Body work now for Lopez. He's 35-2-1. Hopes a couple more wins and he can get into a major fight, but he's still got plenty of work to do here against Daniel Echevarria.
Counters up by Echevarria against the ropes there.
He does everything right, and then that happens to him. Echevarria down for the third time here tonight.
Because the taller Echevarria stood there too long and got hit by that right hook by Lopez.
And that is it. The power is there when Lopez needed it most, and he gets his 21st professional KO. The great equalizer. He was fatigued, perhaps wasn't in the best shape. He was getting outboxed. But Sergio, like you said earlier, there's no reason to panic because he's got that power.
Whenever you got that magic eraser, it just takes one punch. That's the thing about a puncher, Todd. They can keep their cool all the way into the mid rounds and the later rounds because it only takes one punch to turn your lights out.
Yeah, Joel Diaz told us all he has to do is touch you anywhere and every punch hurts. And Echevarria, I'm sure, can vouch for that. An emotional corner there for the Argentine. He did his best, Sergio, but could not overcome the strength from Lopez.
Echevarria was boxing nicely, but that right hook right there really surprised him. You know what? Echevarria, the southpaw, is not expecting right hooks to come from the orthodox fighter, but that's exactly what Lopez did. And the taller fighter, when hurt, shouldn't be against the ropes like that. Just a beautiful right hand by Lopez, and like his trainer said, anything he touches gets hurt.
Fourth straight knockout for Marcelino Lopez, who's now 36-2-1.
Here we're gonna see one more look at that devastating punch. Lopez slips that shot, comes back with a right hook. Beautiful shot by Marcelino Lopez.
Nino does it again. So he improves to 4-1 in the United States, and this guy's a dangerous out for anybody in this division. How likely is it for him to get a big name in the near future?
Well, if he keeps knocking out fighters senseless like that, he's going to get a big shot pretty soon.
We send it back into the ring, and Jeremiah Gallegos.
Ladies and gentlemen, our referee, Rosario Solis, reaches the count of 10, waving a halt to this bout. The official time comes to you into round number 5, 2 minutes, 59 seconds, for your winner by KO, representando Buenos Aires, Argentina, Marcelino Nino
Very impressive knockout there by Marcelino Lopez. It started a little bit slow, but when you have that type of concussive power, it only takes one shot, like we clearly saw against Echeverria. And now we're gonna look at the highlights. Echeverria started out nicely, boxing, staying behind that jab, throwing combinations at distance. Lopez catching Echeverria with that right hand right there. Echeverria showed guts, got up from it. Lopez landing that same shot. Echeverria said that it was behind the head. That wasn't the case, but he showed guts getting up from that punch. Coming back with shots of his own, fighting off the stronger, shorter Lopez. But he stood against the ropes a little bit too long, and Lopez caught him with that brutal left hand. I'm sorry, right hook, and it was over for Echeverria. Another impressive knockout there by that man, Marcelino Lopez. And now we throw it up to Todd Grisham with the winner.
Congratulations on your victory tonight. What was your strategy in this fight? It seemed like he was outboxing you for long stretches, but then you would catch him with your power.
Sí, sí, la verdad que me costó un poquito. Tuve un año de inactividad y creo que me está pasando una jugada. No me puedo soltar. Que es cosa que lo tengo que trabajar en el gimnasio junto con Joel, junto con la preparación. Pero bueno, contento por el triunfo porque es importante.
It took me a while because I have been out of the gym, out of fighting for about a year before my previous fight. And I think that was an effect for this fight, but that's just something that I'm going to fix in the gym working with Joel. But overall, I'm happy for the victory.
How nice is it to know you have that much power that you can end a fight in a split notice?
Lo trabajo con tranquilidad, la verdad que me viene dando buen trabajo y buenos frutos a la derecha. Es algo que lo trabajamos, por eso me pone contento. Pero bueno, yo creo que el Marcelino López que yo quiero mostrar todavía no se desenvolvió en el ring y eso lo vamos a ver pronto.
Absolutely. What I was doing is that I was working on my right hand, and that really was a factor in the ring. But most important, I think that the Marcelino López that people are always seeing showed himself here in the ring, and that's important.
Let's talk to your trainer, Joel Diaz. You told us yesterday how strong this guy is. Compared based on his weight, is he the strongest fighter in your gym right now?
Yes, he's a very powerful kid. When he lets go of his hands, as you can see, every time he lands a punch, it's either with the left or the right, he can hurt you. He has good defense. Obviously, like he said today, it wasn't the Marcelino that people want to see because it's inactivity. But every time he lets go of his hands, he does damage.
Were you concerned about it? He looked like he was getting fatigued as the fight wore on. Were you concerned that maybe he wouldn't be able to get the job done?
I was not concerned because I was asking him in the corner, and he said he was okay. He says, I'm trying to get him to get confident so that I can catch him. He says, what I'm doing is I'm letting him feel confident, come get me so that I can catch him on the way in because he has long reach. So, you know, I know because I work with him that he was just being patient.
Well, you're 33 years old right now. You've found your man strength. You've been out of the ring for a while, now you're back. Who do you want to fight next?
Oh, me encantaría que me dé una posibilidad por un título. Es por lo que vine, sinceramente. Si no es por un título, que sea una pelea importante, que me pongan un plano donde por ahí me den la posibilidad.
What I would really like is a world title opportunity. That's why I'm working hard. But if I can't do that, I want to make an important fight. But I would love the opportunity to fight for a world title.
Congratulations and good luck. One more time, Marcelino Lopez. Coming up at the top of the hour, it's our main card, and right out of the gate, it's Hector Tanahara Jr. He spoke earlier with Claudia Trejos.
Hector, thank you for your time. You're coming up in a division with a lot of your amateur peers like Ryan Garcia, Haney, Teofimo Lopez, and they're on the limelight. What does it take for you to get that type of exposure?
I'll just keep doing what I'm doing, get victories, but I guess close out in knockout fashion, look good in all my fights that are coming up.
Let's talk a little bit about training with Robert Garcia. Obviously, he's got a lot of talent that you are exposed to. You're doing sparring sessions. What name comes up that has taught you the most?
Mikey Garcia. I mean, I've sparred him since I first got with Robert, and he's taught me a lot. So, and he's one of the biggest boxers right now in the world, and I've learned a lot from him, so that's the first that comes to mind.
Oh, but you got to tell me, what did he teach you?
So, taught me a lot of little tricks that are used in the pros. Remember the first time I sparred him, he was just on me the whole time. He's like, "This, if you want to be a world champion, this is what it takes." And he was beating me up that first time. So just a lot of little lessons like that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Three fights down and three to go as we look at tonight's fight card. Coming up at the top of the hour, there's Hector Tanahara Jr. taking on Ezequiel Aviles. But let's mention what happened earlier tonight. Alex Rincon came out and looked great.
Yes, he did. The power punching, that right hook power punch was exactly what he needed right here in his home state of Texas. The fans love it. Very popular. Both brothers have a bright future.
Trayvon Mizon getting a decision win. And then what we just saw from the heavy-handed Argentine. He wants a world title shot next. Do you think he gets it?
I would like to see more because he can be outboxed by the elite. He was getting outboxed by a tough fighter tonight. But I would like to see him utilize and try to win rounds, go further, because he's not going to be able to rely on that power in a 12-round fight. So he will get outboxed. So he needs to fight behind the jab and rely on more than just power.
Well, Lopez has plenty of power, as you saw tonight, but so too does the man featured in tonight's main event, Virgil Ortiz Jr. He's from right here in Grand Prairie, Texas, 13-0 with 13 knockouts. And right now, we're going to show you the top 10 of his young career.
He's done. He's done. He is just fun to watch.
Nice left hook to the liver, and down goes Salgado. I don't think he's getting up, and neither does the referee. Big right hand to the top of the head, and down goes Evandro Caballero.
This fight is over.
To the body, upstairs.
Oh, he drops on the Perez early in the first.
Right hand. A second round stoppage for Virgil Ortiz Jr.
Right hand, end of the fight.
See the eyes of there he goes down.
And that was a jab that
stiff
caught
one, huh?
Right, it caught Garcia coming straight in.
And I don't know if he's getting up for that one.
Looks like both guys are double parked here.
Oh, right hand drops Rodas. A huge right hand from the 18-year-old Virgil Ortiz early on in his pro debut.
Can Ortiz get another knockout tonight in the biggest fight of his life against Antonio Orozco? We'll find out. Our main event, or our main card rather, gets started at the top of the hour. Since we have a few minutes, how about some bonus boxing earlier tonight? It's a cruiserweight showdown, a four-rounder between Cal Kruth and Prather. Here we go. Tristan Calcrith, his pro debut, 17 years old, 6'2" tall, taking on Kendale Prather, 0-1, fighting out of Kansas City, Kansas. Here's Jeremiah Gallegos.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are live on DAZN here at the Lone Star State inside the theater in Grand Prairie, USA, as Oscar De La Hoya's Golden Boy Promotions presents a great night of world-class boxing. This attraction scheduled for four rounds of the cruiserweight division. Introducing to you first, set to make his ring walk and fighting out of the blue corner from Olathe, Kansas, Kendale Prather.
I used to pray for times like this, to grind like this, so I had to grind like that.
Kendale Prather, a former basketball player, played for the Missouri Rhythm, the Topeka Aviators, and the Kansas City Spartans. Also played professionally in the Philippines, where Manny Pacquiao is technically a professional basketball player, but decided to give that up to focus full-time on the sweet science. Please, for the squeeze and get great. Now let them get in between and we'll be started. Look, but I'm lying-hearted. They love me when I was stuck in their head. If I'm not the part of that, go and get it regardless. Draw like I'm an artist. We're crawling, we're straight to walking. We're foreigners and my garages are foreign.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, here we go, making his way to the ring and fighting out of the red corner. And also tonight, making his professional debut from Duncanville, Texas, Tristan Sweet
Calcrith, just 17 years old. Now, in America, you can't fight if you're 17 years old as a professional. He's not going to turn 18 until November. But according to the Texas Department of Licensing and Regulation, a fighter can be licensed in Texas at the age of 17 with parental consent. So there you have it, Sergio.
Yeah, normally you have to cross the border and go into Mexico if you want to fight at 16 years old. But Tristan did it. He's a very, very talented and precocious young man.
So here is our tale of the tape for this fight in the cruiserweight division. Prather, 11 years older than the young teenager Tristan Calcrith, who will have a 5-inch reach advantage. Back now to Jeremiah.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is our opening attraction, our preliminary attraction live on DAZN here at the theater in Grand Prairie, Texas, USA. All brought to you by Oscar De La Hoya's Golden Boy Promotions and sponsored by Tecate, the official beer of boxing, and Hennessy, never stop, never settle. This attraction scheduled for four rounds of the cruiserweight division. The three judges scoring the bout at ringside are Jesse Reyes, Javier Martinez, and David Yakabuchi. And our referee in charge of the sound of the bell, Rosario Solis. And now, ladies and gentlemen, here we go for the introductions. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the black trunks trimmed with red. He officially tipped the scales at 168.6 pounds. Tonight, he is set to make his second professional appearance from Olathe, Kansas, Kendale Prather. And across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the blue trunks trimmed with gold and white, he officially tipped the scales at 178.2 pounds. During his outstanding amateur campaign, he became a three-time USA Boxing National Champion and a competitor of the 2018 World Championships. Tonight, at only 17 years of age, he makes his much-anticipated professional debut here in the great state of Texas. Training out of Irving, Texas, by way of Duncanville, Texas, ladies and gentlemen, Tristan Sweetie Calhoun. And a referee to give the final instructions, Rosario Solis.
Gentlemen, we gave you the instructions in the dressing room. Expect a clean fight, obey my commands, above all, protect yourself at all times. Good luck.
Sweet tea. There's plenty of that here in the sweet tea. There's plenty of that here in the Dallas-Fort Worth greater metropolitan area. But Tristan Calcrith will take that name into his professional debut tonight. You can see he is very tall and rangy, 6'4" with a 79-inch reach. Round one. Calcrith with a straight right hand to get things started. And boy, Prather coming right after him. Welcome to the pro ranks, Tristan.
Prather's coming after him, but his chin is way up in the air.
Well, when you've got someone that is as decorated as an amateur as Calcrith is, maybe Prather's saying, I just got to turn this into a street fight.
That's fine, but Prather better keep that chin down.
Left hook, a good one from Calcrith, and all of a sudden, Prather's bravado is shrinking right before our eyes. Couple of body shots upstairs, and the referee's gonna stop it already. Welcome to the big leagues, kid.
Wow, that was impressive. Not only that knockdown, but that backflip by a 6'4" boxer.
That's how you want to make your mark in your pro debut.
First round knockout with a backflip. Absolutely.
The family is happy. Born in nearby Arlington, Texas, raised and lives in Duncanville. And again, he's only 17, Sergio. What were you doing when you were 17?
I barely started boxing and I wasn't backflipping, I'll tell you that. This kid is very, very talented. The sky's the future for Tristan. Just very, very impressive first round knockout. I ever see Prather with his chin up, a little bit up in the air. I didn't like that from the get-go, but it was a left hook. And the referee stepped in. It was gonna end bad for Prather, but here's the left hook that hurt him because his chin was way up in the air. You need to have that chin tucked in, hands up. That wasn't the case with Kendall Prather tonight. And the referee steps in, avoiding more punishment. Right call. And here's another look of the left hook. Cleanly right on the chin. Prather took it, but the legs weren't under him. And Calcrith does the right thing and go after a wounded fighter. Not forgetting the body, right hand downstairs, left. And watch the backflip here, that's impressive. 6'4", being able to do that and clear that backflip. Just all around impressive by Tristan Calcrith. And now we throw it to Jeremiah Gallegos.
Ladies and gentlemen, our referee Rosario Solis puts a wave to this contest. The official time comes to you. Round number one, 42 seconds. And now, ladies and gentlemen, he's undefeated in his professional debut tonight. From Duncanville, Texas, you're winning by TKO, Tristan Sweet Tea Calcrith.
Well, he told us, Sweet Tea told us he wanted to be quick on his feet. Shoulder roll, use his jab, stay in range. None of that was needed. Just came out and blasted the winless Prather tonight. I mean, this is what you think about when you're making your pro debut. The amateurs is one thing, but as a pro, you want to come out. The first round knockouts are very difficult to get, but good for Tristan here. Now we throw it to Todd Grisham.
All right, Tristan, congratulations on your win. All right, Tristan, congratulations on your win. What was this like making your pro debut here in Texas?
It was great. I really want to thank the fans. You know, the fans, it was like they were fighting with me inside the ring. So I want to give a huge shout out to the fans. Coach Ronnie, you know, I'm very grateful, very humbled to be in this position right now. Especially, I never thought I would be here at 17 years old. So I'm just very grateful. But huge shout out to the friends in Grand Prairie, Texas. Thank you.
How surprised were you with his tactic of basically coming right out and turning this into a brawl?
I mean, there's many fighters. He's not the first one that came at me wild. You know, mm-hmm. I have over 102 fights, 92-9. So I'm a well experienced fighter.
All right. Let's watch your handiwork here on this screen. Oh, there we are, everybody. Let's watch your work here, Tristan. Take us through this knockout.
I saw he was open up, and the left hook was right there. I was just listening to Coach Ronnie. He was saying the straight right and left hook's going to be there. So I was looking for it, and it landed.
And then here comes this big left hook right against the ropes, right there.
That's all that was wrote.
Now take us through the backflip. You're 6'4". You're not supposed to be able to do that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, man. I need to stop before I hurt myself. I'm getting kind of tall.
I know your friends and family appreciated your work here tonight. Congratulations, everybody. Give it up for Tristan Calcriff. Congratulations to the 17-year-old on his win tonight earlier. In fact, in America, you can't fight until you're 18 without your parents' permission. He got that, and he got his first professional win. We are live on DAZN at the theater at Grand Prairie. Four fights down. We've had some pretty entertaining scraps so far. Todd Grisham alongside Sergio Mora. And we'll start with Alex Rincon, who's from nearby Greater Dallas. And boy, did he look good.
Both brothers looked really good, but it was the right hooks and the body shots that really impressed me by these two young guys. Just brutal body shots right here. Combinations, right hand, left. And ultimately that right hand was way too much. He was out.
So Rincon improves to 7-0 with 6 KOs. Then it was Trevell Maison and Jeremy Ramos.
You gotta hand it to Ramos. He took some good shots, got up from getting knocked down, but Maison did his thing. Stayed composed, fighting behind the jab, doing a little shimmy there. It was a good learning experience for Maison.
Maison hadn't fought in a year because of a torn left bicep. He came out, looked good, walked through all the punches that he was hit with, handled it well, and got a comfortable decision win. And then the fight we just saw.
This was actually pretty impressive. Echeverria boxing nicely. There he goes, down by that punch by Lopez. But Lopez was just stalking and prowling. He knew that it only was going to take one punch to end this fight, and that's exactly what happened.
He was outboxed by the Mexican fighter for most of the fight, but he had the power when he needed it. 3 knockdowns in all, and that would be all she wrote. He wants a world title shot. If not next, then very soon. Here's a look back at the fight card, and of course, coming up next, top of the hour, our main card begins 9 p.m. Eastern time. Hector Tanahara Jr. taking on Ezequiel Aviles.
Aviles is not much of a puncher. He needs to get inside with the taller, rangier technician in Tanahara. He says this is going to be his night, but Tanahara wasn't too impressed with his last performance and looking to make a statement tonight.
And then our co-main event. It is the third fight of a trilogy between Franco and Negrete. Not much has separated at all in the first two fights. What's going to be the difference here in the third one?
I'm curious to know myself, because the first one was a draw. The second one was a controversial split decision for Franco. I thought Negrete deserved that fight. He landed more shots at a higher percentage. He was very bitter and spiteful with the judging of that fight, but he has another opportunity to show that he can win this fight and win the trilogy.
And this crowd has been buzzing all night as their native son returns home. The first ever boxing match in this arena. And this is where he graduated high school. Virgil Ortiz Jr., unbeaten 13-0 with 13 KOs against Antonio Orozco.
Ortiz has everything going for him, inside the ring, outside the ring. He has the great trainer in his corner. But Orozco, determined. His only loss is with the unified champion, Jose Ramirez. No shame in that loss. With that experience, he can take the momentum into this fight with Virgil Ortiz Jr.
And Ortiz Jr. is not only confident that he's going to pass this test against Orozco, he's confident he's going to knock the veteran out. Can he do it? We'll find out next. Our main card starts now on DAZN.
Virgil Ortiz, experienced, even though he is only 21 years old, a serious young fighter who comes in with an unblemished record.
Antonio Orozco, nicknamed Relentless, only one loss. Orozco has promised to shine here tonight.
Ortiz with a beautiful hook, and then right hand, that hurts.
How about the underdog showing up tonight?